Hi, folks, and welcome to another episode of the Leadership Tales podcast. I'm delighted to have Bryan Wish on the episode today. Bryan and I met through a post I was doing. I was sat in my favorite breakfast restaurant, and I was doing a LinkedIn sprint. And I had a copy of Michael Bungay Stania's book, and I took a photograph, and I asked the question, what other voices should I listen to? And Bryan's voice was one that somebody posted and said, you should be talking to Bryan Wish. And I couldn't have thanked this person who recommended Bryan more. And he runs a company called Arcbound, who are now doing our social media. And they're starting to work with me around getting my message honed, my arc honed. So you hear today a story from an individual who's done his own work. And I'm a big fan of that. He'll mention Brené Brown today. And I'm a big fan of Brené in terms of getting into the arena and doing your own work. And therefore, he's used that to shape the organization that we're working with in Arcbound. Amazingly connected person, grounded person in terms of what he does. So I'm sure you'll enjoy the conversation with Bryan Wish today.
Way where it's not just about work, it's just about the whole table and really letting my heart kind of guide me and having skills now to do things I never knew possible. Just it's been one heck of a life thus far, and proud of where we are at 29 years old.
One of the things I loved about your story and how we connected was firstly the intentionality, as you describe it, around that. And I love the tightrope GPS piece in there, because there is a bit, life throws stuff at you. But I'd love to just explore, if you're okay to go there, about how you did the work to get there. Because we're talking about building more human leaders, leading with our heart, bringing the human back into here. And you've got a work that you've done, and you've got some great videos to go with us about the work you've done. So I'd love you to share, if you're okay, around how you did that.
Yeah. When I left for Denver, where in DC, to kind of start this personal track, which really was so connected to as I was finding myself personally, if I had to really do that work, I think, to help other people find themselves professionally and accelerate that arc. But when I left, I was in a place of, I think, extreme brokenness. I mean, I'd never been so lost and unsure and insecure and shattered, right? With my sense of identity and self. Because I'd put, who I was in relationships or work and all these pieces, right? And I think it's a common thing we all do as high-achieving entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. Something that I have always sought out growing up was highly intelligent, emotionally equipped male figures who are older than I was. And I couldn't maybe at the time realize why I always gravitated towards men like that. One, it was my ex's father. Then it was my step uncle growing up. But the person that really kind of rose to the occasion, his name was Rich Keller, and he came out and visited me in Denver. And just background on him, you talk about doing the work, left his own biological family, severed those relationships, had a lot of trauma growing up. He had cancer, his wife had cancer. He's probably one of the most emotionally equipped men I've ever met. So he came out to visit me, and I was in a pretty dark place. And he said something to me, he said, "Look, I'm going to help raise you up to see the value in that everyone else sees in you. And I'm going to guide you through." And it was in this journey, with him, where I literally broke down in his arms multiple times in that week. It was cleansing and ripping apart, just letting go of so much of the pain of the past. And so over the last year and a half, it's morphed into this incredible spiritual guidance of relationship. And he has kids and a wife and a great guy that has shown up for me and shown me how to care and helped equip me in a way where I was emotionally, where I could help others now, so special. But it helped me kind of understand my past, how I showed up in the world because of certain events, how that impacted me in relationships, in my work, how I was a people pleaser, how I, feared loss, and dug into that. I think one of the biggest gifts from the work was I'm finally present to the world, to myself.
Yeah.
I was running so much from suffering, trying to not face life, in a way, without realizing it. But now, the way I see things is so clear, almost in a way where it's more painful, but I'd rather live this way than the reverse. So, you say, how did you do the work, or what did you do? I had someone who mirrored me at every step. I mean, this was 3-4 nights a week in the worst of it, for 2 hours. It was work from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m., go to the gym, come back 8 p.m. to 10 Mountain Time or West Coast Time, get on Zoom and just work through it. And something I have to this day, it's an 80-page insight stock, and it's on my life, and all the things I learned and have been learning working with them. And so I got very lucky to find somebody. To the biggest gift I'll probably have in my life is what's transpired over the last almost 2 years now.
I think for me, there's something in here because, we talk about the male archetype, and we talk about the fact that a lot of men struggle to
to be emotional, to share their feelings. And, you know, I was brought up to mask a lot of that. And therefore, you know, when I had my breakdown when I was 30, a lot of that came out. And I remember that, you know, I had to go find somebody else to go talk these things through. And it's, I think the world is more accepting now of that. But I find it refreshing when I talk to you and the work you're doing at the moment, because it's also led to a culture in your Arcbound team that I think is exceptional because of it. Do you want to talk about how that's translated into the leadership in the business? Yeah.
So I'll tell you a pretty raw story. And maybe you'll relate to this. I had lunch with a client in New York. His name's Robert Livingston, and he's one of the most, I'd say, intuitive, thoughtful, also like highly distinguished individuals, you know, I've ever met. And he looked at me and he said, look, he was like, I'm still with you guys because I think you're going to be the best at what you do. And then your team and you, like the heart and the soul of your business, is I've never seen anything like it. Mm-hmm. But with that, there needs to be a level of polish and like up leveling to be the best and to put in some structure without losing the soul of the business. And those are some things we're working through. But I think to the second point of having heart and soul, you know, I think it's extremely evident. We've hired people who I think are here just because they see and feel the deeper vision, not just for the clients they're serving, but for themselves. Because they need to have a path that's authentic to who they are as well. And if we're helping clients live out an authentic way, an expression of who they are as well, that's a really meaningful identity to build as an organization. Mm-hmm. And so we've been able to attract, you know, my friend wrote a book called The Founders, and it's on the PayPal Mafia. Mm-hmm. And at the beginning of the book, it talks about how it's a bunch of, you know, in PayPal's early days, it was a bunch of misfits.
Yeah.
And you look at our team, these aren't like normal, like agency folks. They're not normal, like corporate people. I mean, these people are all super weird in like, in their own unique way. It's like beautifully weird, right? Mm. Like we're all a little different. And they've been drawn to what we're doing. And, you know, what that brings to your point is, I think, this heart and soul that they feel really connected and inspired. Someone text me on my team yesterday named Sam, one of our writers who works closely with Morgan. And he said, thanks for giving me a home. Hmm. And he's married and has a good family, but and kids, but like he's expressed, this is the first place he's really felt like he's had a home. And so to create that kind of culture where people can express who they are, speak up, be themselves. That's a gift. And I think very rare in today's corporate world of money and greed and all the things that drive organizations. That's never been the focus for me. It's been create a lot of good inputs. Hopefully there's some good byproducts at the end of the day.
And there are. And I love the weird piece because I'm a big fan of weird. And, you know, we all have a bit of weird in us all over the place. And, you know, some people could say, well, that's a bit judgmental. But it's not. We all have either doubt in ourselves or we don't feel we fit. And we've been in large. I mean, I describe myself as a corporate refugee in a lot of ways. That, you know, I ran away from Procter & Gamble. I ran away from a number of different organizations. So creating different homes for different people is important to allow them a space to come there. What I love about that is also the variety of your clients, because that gives a variety of voices to a variety of different people in there. Tell us a bit about your clients, if you can, Justin, and who you work with, because it is an eclectic mix. Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks, Colin. And I feel like you've seen us from day one. And been patient, and I just that means the world to have the right people. A lot of our clients are lead high level organizations or consultants and authors and have organizations around them and really putting a message on people on something they want to give away. Other people that also make up the audience, there's some high-level CEOs that run big companies, mid-sized companies, you know, who also want to get in front of their story, their brand, on behalf of their organization, and let people really connect to them. And then we've noticed actually, you know, some traction in the investor market. You know, they realize, you know, they have stories, and how do they differentiate from competition? So I think it's people at the intersection of ideas, leading people around those ideas, and trying to have like a meaningful impact on the world, where the expression of their work, it may come out in many different ways, but at the core of it, you know, they want to bring their whole self out, find a meaningful trajectory beyond just functionally what they call themselves. And I think that's what unites them together. And we've noticed, you know, where some companies might grow on, I think, a lot of like false distribution and, you know, a lot of things that, you know, to actually take some time. We've done, I think, a really good job, and we have a long way to go, but, you know, really building community amongst our organization and connecting clients in super meaningful ways. And I'm just going to be doing a lot of new things in the new year to really, you know, facilitate that further. But, you know, how do we identify which clients should know each other, and how do opportunities come from that? And the clients, they really believe in who we are and where we're going, and a little patient, like I talk about with Robert, because they see that vision and to wake up and push that vision forward every day is an honor.
The purposeful side is a massive bit for me, because, you know, we're on a purposeful journey. We're working towards something where we're impacting on society, and we're trying to do that. And your story echoes with me in terms of there's so many different moving parts, from the amazing Morgan who works with myself, who just, I think, is needs a shout out from me, because I've never met somebody who's as an exceptional a writer as she is in terms of her content.
I'll give you actually, can I build on that real quick?
Yeah, of course.
I was in a cabin last fall around this time, actually, maybe like 2 weeks prior. We'll call it the Morgan anniversary. I woke up in a dream thinking about her. She I went to college with her.
Yeah.
And she wrote on my first website I created in college.
Amazing.
And something was like, reach out to Morgan and see what she's up to. I haven't talked to Morgan in 4 years. So I texted her. I said, Morgan, I'm weirdly thinking about you. What are you up to? Are you open to work?
Mm.
And the rest is history, you know.
Yeah,
it was
amazing.
Literally like a download. I don't know. It was just the weirdest thing. It was the first thing I did at like 7 a.m. when I woke up was text her. And I hadn't thought about her for years. It was so weird. But I'm so glad that, you know, your experience with her has been positive. But it was so trippy how she ended up here.
And I think it's a reflection also, just because, you know, I was chatting to Chris Tuff, who's also one of your clients in here, and we were on the podcast recording, and his whole being is about connection. And I've got a good friend, Chad Littlefield, who's connection before content in here. But my sense is you live and breathe that, because the amount of connections, introductions that you've made for me is exceptional. But that's the intentionality, isn't it? That's what you're trying to build here, is a community. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, I think connecting to people is one part of it. I think finding your, accelerating your journey and path, it takes people. And I think when you know, right, if we can help clients, help people identify where they want to go and what that unique arc can look like.
Mm.
And it's easy to identify people along that journey of who they should talk to, when, why, and kind of let the natural next steps unfold. And because I, you know, I'm trying to build with an organization more of a builder mentality, to understand that vision of a client and that journey they need to go down to get to where they want, helping them intercept with the right people at the right time can lead to, I think, a lot of significant opportunities and results. So it is very intentional. And through that, right, you can build a great community. And so videos for 4 hours on YouTube on how to do something. I'm just going to find the person who's done it, reach out to them, and kind of expedite faster. That's just my way of doing it. And I think then through that, I've met some amazing people. And then to get to share those people with others who then go build more relationships, you can create a ripple effect that you'll never understand or be able to quantify, but can be a very powerful impact in the world when I think well-intentioned people come together to do great and meaningful work.
That thought about you as a person, going back to the structure, though, the structure is still important. So the feedback Robert gave you is in there. And yeah, you made a comment at the time, which is probably resonate. Yes, I do. I mean, for me, I have a concept called squirreling. So I squirrel, and I could squirrel through connections, through connections, through connections, building relationships. But as you say, it's an arc. What's the arc through those connections? And sometimes it's not the most obvious at the beginning, but to get a structure behind that is important. So tell me about the challenges on that, because you're working with Mark Green, who just an exceptional character, again, one of your team to do that.
Right. So, I mean, first off, I hired Mark. Mark works with a lot of mid-market CEOs who are building $10 to $100 million businesses. And while we're not there yet, I thought it would be a very proactive move because, one, it's going to impact the team and also our clients.
Yeah.
And them together. You know, the biggest challenge we face is we're working with very sophisticated, highly clients who have had achieved a lot of success and who expect the best, not just for themselves in their career, but in the partners they work with and everything in between. And they're always pushing for more and they're always pushing for better. At the same time, we're in a very new industry, I think very much at the front of the thinking of that industry and how we're doing it, why we're doing it. And we've hired a team who is, I think, exceptional with heart and soul and vision, but also needs to be evolved in thinking and progression and getting in front of clients' journey and really owning that client experience. So in terms of challenges, it's how we raise our team who's younger, who has the skill sets functionally to execute on clients' behalf, but then emotionally engage, get in front of the journey and really bring it all together, because they're just a little bit younger, but they need to think with a mindset that might be 20 years beyond what they have today. And so the level of rigor and discipline and thinking that needs to be brought into this organization, which is something we are really working towards and we'll get right, is probably the biggest challenge. And I think any company, right, in this space is going to face this challenge because it's a lot of younger individuals with these skill sets. It's a market that caters to people who are more sophisticated until something more streamlined can be built. And it's going to require the team to really get into the heart of the client and not just functionally execute the work, but really engage. And so I would say in terms of challenges, right, of where we are as an organization is, I think the vision's sound. I think that we have a really sound team, but from a polish and structure of really how to deliver on that, it is where our biggest opportunity and challenge is ahead. But that excites me because it's so clearly in front of me and I'm so present to it as a leader that that's what I'm going to beat down over the organization to make sure we get right. And I think that's the biggest challenge in front of us to survive. And that to me, if we get right, or when we get it right, I think will be significant for how we do things here. And I'm excited to learn how to do it.
So the key things for me when I look back and that are equivalent to our journey, one is picking unlikely leaders, the characters who have this passion, this heart. And then it's about these younger folk who, work with them to develop them on their journey to do that. And also it's, for me, it's thought leadership. Because I remember sitting in a session on thought leadership and going, I can never be a thought leader. I don't have the intellect, don't have the capability. And therefore, for the number of people, if I was sat there thinking that, I had to work on the practice leadership first to craft that and go. So I'm thinking just to my daughters and thinking, how do they get to the point of having the confidence to sit in there? So getting ahead of thought leaders, CEOs when you're younger is a challenge, even if you've got the basic foundational skills. So yeah,
I appreciate you sharing that. And also, I mean, I think another note at a brand level, right? You know, talk to really own, let's just say, your path, and like to use that path to build an arc, really focusing on like owning who you are as an individual, because you have to, you know, Brene Brown talks a lot about belonging and how belonging isn't like attaching yourself to an organization or a relationship or an outgroup, something that is an extension, but it's about really like being able to stand alone or stand with others freely. And to be a thought leader to me at a very deep level, right? Like I had to go do that journey for myself to not just functionally talk about building what we're doing, but like being okay on my own to share the things I need to share and helping our clients also do the same. So for those who are like, oh, I'm scared to share, of imposter syndrome around, like, am I worthy to have a voice? I think part of this journey that we're taking clients through, it's not just a functional one, but it's an emotional one to get comfortable in their voice and their skin to be themselves.
Yeah.
And the byproducts of that work, you can't even quantify when you're helping an individual express themselves in a way that is scary. And so just to kind of bring together everything you said, part of that is at the root of what we're doing. I think we're helping people just own themselves. And that's really special because that's a healing journey in and of itself.
I think the purposeful practice I found that is quite cathartic to go through the process, to work with Morgan, talk, share concepts, test it. And, you know, I live through experimentation, so writing something, getting it out there in the world, but also just some of the challenging pieces about putting something, I'm like, you know, I'm going to hide. We have tall poppy syndrome in the UK where you don't want to put your head too high, stoop, you know, come from a stoop position, and therefore people might not notice you out there. But pushing some of that out there and putting some thoughts around a wisdom focus, so getting people to talk and share is one of the powers of working with Morgan around the purposeful practice. But I think the second thing that I've really loved is the ability to network in a group of people who want to share their story and want to see and learning from them. And I think a lot of us, even just simple thing like networking, Bryan, is a tough thing to share your story, go into a room and work. But because of the work you do, it's about paying it forward. It's about how can I connect with the other person in front of you? So that, I think that's the other power that you bring. Can you tell a bit about the networking piece? Because I think that's how you build a network and how you consciously build your network.
I'll never forget, I was a senior in high school. And my dad was, we were driving up in his driveway and we were kind of parked in the garage. And my dad shared some nuggets with me along the way that, you know, I think have always stuck and kind of landed with me at the right time. Seemed to forget everything else he shared with me, but that's okay. So.
That's a longer story.
But one of the things he said to me was, I'd be a lot further in my career if I learned how to build relationships. That really kind of hit me. I don't know why it did. I didn't know how I'd ever apply that or carry that forward. And, you know, background, you know, he did well in the mortgage business and all the things, but so I thought about the statement and I was like, he would have been much further. Like, it was hard to understand at the time. And when I got to college when I was a freshman, you know, my mom sent me a book. It was called The Power of Who. And it was a book about breaking into the sports industry. And at the time I was trying to find a sports industry. I was trying to work in sports and combine passion for sports and business. And so when she sent me that book, it talked all about like how to connect with people and engage them meaningfully to help get to where you want to go and how it's about the relationships. And just even through that, you know, I remember I created a database of like 150 like organizations and people, and I had a communication process and I learned how to reach out and set up conversations and meetings, and eventually got an internship as a freshman in college at a sports organization, which is a very hard thing to do given how competitive sports is.
Yeah.
So I started to kind of build the kind of tool belt. You know, networking is someone and what they're about. Because through that, when you ask the right questions, you get to know someone. Maybe you can connect the dots to different things they've experienced in life because you've read something, had a conversation around it, have an experience traveling, kind of can connect empathetically there. And then also ask questions around, okay, basically with this, where do they want to go? You know, because I'm always curious about people, what they're trying to do next. Yeah. It makes it really easy for me to say, follow up and say, here are a few resources that I think you'd really appreciate and like. Here's a few people that I think would be amazing for you to know. Mm-hmm. And in a way that's like very selfless because it's just, they should know these people. And I think, you know, I was never the smartest with IQ. I always had to work a little bit harder. I think relationships have been the piece that's enabled me to accelerate my own life and career in a way that I would have never anticipated by doing it in a way that I think has helped so many other people. So when I think if we were to break this down, I've never really kind of shared this process-wise, but I think it's around the questions.
Mm-hmm.
People with where they want to go with resources. Those resources could be books, people, mm-hmm. you know, things to do to, you know, experience themselves. And that's why I think it's important to be intellectually thirsty, you know, emotionally equipped, and experienced in the way you navigate the world, because you, what you can give away to other people, not financially, but from a pure human experience, can have a lot much more richness and depth.
I love that. I was listening to something, and it was talking about Bill Clinton, about before he got into politics, he started his little cards in the days we wrote on cards. And when he had connections, he got notes, he wrote notes, and then he would go through that those cards, and he would dial a few people a night in the days of the telephone rather than the Zoom call. And he would work it. So by the time he got to needing it politically, he had something like 10,000, I think it was, that he had that now digitally. But I think the commonality in there is that he did it before he needed it. And it was always about the other people, the connections, the notes. And everybody said that he was one of the most impactful. I had a good friend who was at Time magazine. He said he always was the most impressive person because he always made you feel the most special person in the world when you met them. And I just wanted to make that link to close us with. I'm going to end it with one question, but I want to make that because you have that ability as well to make somebody feel special when you meet them. So I just want to say that that's what I felt when I met you. So it's a real skill. So,
well, you do too, Colin. I think it takes one to know one.
No, it's great. So going to the question, always ask people, but you know, it's an interesting one for me. And you are in the moment person. So if you had to go back to one experiment or one thing that maybe was a mistake or a failure in your life that's been the biggest teacher for you, what would it be?
You know, I wrote something a couple weeks ago, basically about, you know, just back to this emotional journey. You know, the skills that I've been granted or afforded and to be equipped with, thanks to Rick, right? My father wasn't. And I remember, like, sitting down at the end of this relationship that I was in, like, say goodbye, the gratefuls, all the things. And I remember one of the things that was shared with me, which was like, one of the reasons we're here is because, you know, essentially, you know, I didn't have the emotional skills to carry forth, you know, to support somebody the way they needed to be supported. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, without this like fortress, you know, I talked about breaking and really making me like, mm-hmm. face my like robotic and functional way of like moving through the world, like I would have eventually hit the breaking point, and I don't know how I would have maybe turned left or right or straight, but I look at that being like the biggest gift I've ever been given, because of what it's enabled me to do and how I can go show up for the world. And it was in that moment, you know, when I told myself I'll never be in this position again, just like when I was let go in a sense from a job and I said, I'm never going to work for someone again. Like I'm going to give someone that control over me. but it's like how you reply and respond to that. You know, and I'm so grateful for the gift, you know, of things kind of blowing up, because I've made significant changes, and it makes me so proud of the work I've been able to do. So I'd say that,
yeah,
I thought a lot about that over the last year and a half.
Yeah, that's a powerful one, Bryan. Thank you for sharing. Bryan, it's been an absolute delight. If people want to find out more about Arcbound, yourself, where would they find you?
I am Bryan at Bryan Wish on LinkedIn, Bryan at arcbound.com, for email, you know, arcbound.com. So thank you, Colin. It's been a treat. You always seem to bring out the rawness in me, so I'm thrilled to spend the time together.
Hey, it's a pleasure to be working with you and talking with you, sir. Thank you so much, and I'm sure you'll be on here again at some point to share the next part of the story. Looking forward to it.
So that was Bryan Wish. Bryan, amazing gentleman, intellectual thirsty. I love that. I love that term. There's something about the way he's built his business, the way he's exploring the business, his transparency. Also his work he's done himself, and as a male, in terms of some of the background and not wanting to share emotions. There's a story there about how you can and how you can do your work. Age of 29. I mean, wow, what he's achieved, what he is achieving is superb. So I'm sure you got a lot out of that conversation. Sure you got a lot out of listening to him speak. If you want to connect, please do so. And I'll look forward to welcoming you back on another episode of the Leadership Tales podcast very shortly.